Every moment of our lives, you and I are surrounded by a surging sea of electromagnetic radiation. This radiation is in the form of energy waves that travel 186,000 miles per second. And the only way that we can know about these waves, that they exist, is the great principle that electromagnetic radiation interacts with matter by absorption, transmission, or scattering. In this lecture, which is the 15th of our series, we're going to continue the theme of the electromagnetic spectrum. Last time we saw that waves can be characterized by their speed, by their wavelength, by their frequency, and that these three quantities are interrelated by the simple equation that wavelength times frequency equals speed. Electromagnetic waves all travel 186,000 miles per second. That is in a vacuum. So that you have to specify either the wavelength or the frequency, and you know everything there is to know about those waves. Those two quantities are inversely proportional, by the way, so that the wavelength is equal to c, the speed of light, divided by frequency, or the frequency is equal to c, the speed of light, divided by wavelength. There's a nice symmetry there. The longer the wavelength, the lower the frequency, and also the lower the energy. The shorter the wavelength, the higher the frequency, and the higher the energy. Remember, it takes a lot more energy to wiggle something fast. That's a higher frequency wave. The electromagnetic spectrum is a continuum, with wavelengths varying from many miles to a fraction of an inch, indeed the size of an atomic nucleus at the shortest end. This spectrum has no sharp boundaries, but it's conveniently divided into seven broad divisions. And this is based primarily on their distinctive modes of generation and uses, that is, on technological grounds. In the last lecture, we examined radio waves. Those are the longest usually used waves of the electromagnetic spectrum. In this lecture, I'm going to tell you about microwaves and infrared radiation, about visible light, ultraviolet, X-rays, and gamma rays, increasingly higher energy, increasingly higher frequency waves of the electromagnetic spectrum. First, microwaves. Microwaves include electromagnetic radiation with wavelengths from about a third of a millimeter to up to a third of a meter, or about a foot long. That range overlaps with the shortest radio waves, and there's no clear divide between radio and microwave. Microwave frequencies, consequently, because of their length, range from about 1 billion to 100 billion cycles per second. That's 1 to 100 gigahertz. A gigahertz is a billion cycles per second. Recall that wavelength times frequency equals 186,000 miles per second, or 300,000 kilometers per second. And that's true for all different kinds of electromagnetic waves, so it's really easy to convert from wavelength to frequency, remembering that constant speed. Microwaves are produced primarily by a rapid oscillating electrical field or magnetic field, and they find a number of common uses in technologies, and we're going to look at three of those: cooking, communications, and radar. Probably the most frequent everyday application of microwaves that you'll see is in microwave ovens, in cooking. Here's how it works. The microwave oven relies on the fact that water molecules, H2O molecules, which are present in all different kinds of food that you eat, actually absorb microwaves of a particular frequency, 2.45 gigahertz. When you apply a frequency of 2.45 gigahertz to a water molecule, it starts vibrating rapidly. It absorbs that energy. It oscillates at that frequency. So you can heat up water molecules by exposing them to these microwaves. So here's a technology that's widely used today for heating homes, in heating food in your home, but also it's used in many different technologies and industries because you can use other wavelengths of microwave to heat up other kinds of materials. So it's sometimes used to heat up in synthetic laboratories and so forth. So microwaves are finding widespread use for heating applications. The effect of heating by microwaves was reportedly discovered by a physicist named Percy Spencer. And I haven't been able to find much about Percy Spencer, but I can imagine the situation. He was a physicist working in the early days of microwaves. And he went into his laboratory and he had microwave generators and he had microwave conduits. And he set his sandwich lunch on top of the microwave machine and went about his work. And when he went at lunchtime to pick up that sandwich, it was totally fried. Well, a lot of people had just been disgusted and thrown away their sandwich, but apparently Percy Spencer realized that, hey, this is a great way to heat up food, and so he pursued the effect, and the microwave oven was born. My father knew about this effect also. My father, in the early 1940s, was a radio antenna repair person, and he did a lot of work in microwave relays towers. He tells a story when he climbed up and worked inside one of the cones of these large microwave transmitters. You could only work for a couple of minutes because your body would overheat so quickly as the microwaves were being transmitted. So at least the antenna repairman of that period knew something about microwaves and their ability to heat up objects as well. The microwave oven is a beautifully designed and very simple device. It has a microwave generator called a magnetron. And a magnetron is a device which simply is designed to oscillate a magnetic field at about 2.5 gigahertz. So this device, which has an oscillator in one portion, then produces microwaves, which are then focused and reflected through a conduit. Then the microwave oven itself is just a box into which you pour microwaves. This box has to have two characteristics. The first is that microwaves have to be reflected off the inside surface, inside the box where you put food. Because as the microwaves pour into the box, they scatter, bounce off, and then are eventually absorbed by the food. But the outside walls of the microwave have to be opaque to microwaves, so the microwaves don't leak out. When you look at your microwave oven, then you know that there's a box. And the other main device is a magnetron, which merely fits on the side of that box and pumps microwaves into the box. That's how the microwave oven works. Another important application of microwaves is in communication. Microwaves can be focused in a narrow beam like a flashlight. They're not easily scattered by air. And as a result, you have a real difference between the microwaves being transmitted and, for example, radio waves, which are emitted in all directions. When you want to send out radio signals from a radio station, you want to reach people all around. And so a non-directional signal is what you want. But when you want to have private, secure communication, you want point-to-point communication from one point to another and not have people on the side being able to pick up that transmission. So microwaves are particularly useful in this regard. You need to have a direct line of sight with microwave communications. That's why you see microwave relay towers dotting the countryside. These are going to be tall towers with sort of odd cone-shaped devices, and they'll be pointed in one direction or another. They're linking different microwave towers, so there's a communication network of microwave relay stations. By the way, most cellular phones at one point or another, and also satellite communication, use microwave relay. But when you have your headset, your handset, it can't have a point-to-point kind of communication. It has to radiate signals in all directions because you're moving. And as you move, you have to be able to get your signals to a central receiving station. For that reason, that first step between your handset and the main relay station, anybody can listen into your conversation, which is why cell phone conversations are not secure, even though the point-to-point microwave communication is. And then there's a third application, that's radar. Radar uses the reflection of microwaves off solid objects. A radar antenna often acts as both the transmitter and the receiver. Microwaves are sent out from that dish, and then they're reflected back to the dish. You can tell the direction of an object by seeing where the reflection comes back. You can also, using the time it takes for a pulse to go out and come back, you can say how far away it is, the distance to the object. And finally, by little shifts in the wavelength, you send out one wavelength, the wavelength may come back slightly shifted by what's called the Doppler effect. And that can help tell you the velocity of the object that you're picking up by radar. Modern military radar is amazing. It's so sensitive that it's said you can pick up a house fly at a distance of a mile with modern military radar. So that's a very, very sensitive way to pick up the distance, the direction, and the speed of an object. You can jam radar in a number of different ways. One is to simply broadcast a very high-intensity microwave beam yourself, which swamps the radar detector. Another is to drop lots of pieces of shiny metal material, which act as reflectors and confuse the radar because the radar picks up so many different hits, so many different echoes. We also now are working on stealth technology, and I'm sure you've seen pictures of the beautiful stealth fighters and stealth bombers. In the early days, those stealth equipment had lots of flat, smooth surfaces, and the flat surfaces acted partly as reflecting mirrors for microwaves. You can imagine if you got a bunch of mirrors, you have to be at exactly the precise angle with respect to the object before it reflects any signal back to you. So mirror-like surfaces are one way to achieve a stealth kind of appearance. The more recent stealth equipment, though, has microwave absorbing materials that are much smoother in their surface, and so that works in a slightly different way. In any case, you can imagine some of these stealth fighters have the appearance of a house fly at about a mile. They're such great radar absorbing materials so that they really are almost invisible to radar. To summarize microwaves, you've seen that they're produced, like all electromagnetic radiation, by wiggling in a magnetic field or an electric field. That's how you produce them. They're easily transmitted through air, so you can use them for communication. The right wavelength, 2.5 gigahertz, are absorbed by water, so you can use them for heating food. And finally, with radar, you can use the scattering properties of materials to detect objects flying in the air. Now we're going to move up the electromagnetic spectrum, and next we come to infrared radiation. That's heat radiation. Infrared includes all the electromagnetic waves from about 1,000th to about 1,000,000th of a meter long. Infrared radiation is emitted by every hot object. You feel this radiation as heat. This means that your skin is actually a very sensitive detector of infrared radiation. So I kind of gave you a misrepresentation in the last lecture. We can see visible light, but we also have a detector for infrared. That's heat radiation. When you feel the warmth of an object, your skin is actually detecting infrared. Many nocturnal animals with night vision actually see, they actually image infrared, because at nighttime, living things are warmer than their surroundings. This becomes a very important way of finding food or avoiding predators at nighttime. In a similar way, infrared technology, the imaging technologies that have been developed by humans, are very important in a whole variety of ways. We have infrared vision goggles, which can be used at nighttime to detect other people, other warm objects. These were first developed by the military, but they're finding many other uses as well. For example, you can use an infrared kind of imaging system to photograph houses at night and look for warm areas and cooler areas. You can see how well the insulation is working. If you have a poorly insulated attic, if you have a window frame that's leaking, you can see that on infrared film at nighttime because the heat will leak out of the house in those places, and you can image it on the film. There are many non-military applications of satellite infrared imaging as well. For example, you can use these to track forest fires. You can use it to monitor pollution by factories. And also, infrared satellites have been used now to monitor volcanoes, because when a volcano is about to erupt, the top of the volcano starts getting a little bit warm as the magma, the hot magma, comes closer to the surface. And you can therefore detect whether or not a volcano is about to erupt. Then we come to visible light, lying almost smack in the middle of our electromagnetic spectrum. It covers a very narrow range, only 400 to 700 billionths of a meter. It's defined as the wavelengths that our eyes can detect, and that's about the range. There's nothing special about this range from a physics point of view, but our ability to see this narrow region is what's so critical, and that's why we give it a separate category, and it's quite understandable why we do that. The visible light spectrum is further divided into colors, and those are smaller divisions of wavelength. The colors of the visual spectrum aren't equal in width, by the way. You'll see that red and green on the visible spectrum are quite broad, but yellow is extremely narrow. It's a band from only about 570 to 590 billionths of a meter. Very narrow range. Our eyes are extremely sensitive to yellow for an interesting reason. It turns out that's also the most intense wavelength of light coming from the sun. And so our eyes are extremely well adapted to daytime vision on planet Earth. If we evolved with a different kind of star, or if we evolved for nighttime vision, we clearly have other sensitivities, but our eyes are sensitive to visible light that's most prominent during the daytime hours. Isaac Newton made a very interesting demonstration in that glorious pair of years, 1665, 1666. He studied the nature of colors, and he realized that all the colors of the rainbow, when combined, create white light. He used prisms to decompose white light into colors, and then a second prism to reassemble those colors back into white light. In fact, this is the definition of white light. It's really a physiological definition, just the way we perceive all the colors in combinations. It turns out our eyes have three different kinds of color receptors called cones. These detect red and green and blue, and when you combine red, green, and blue together at the same time, you perceive the color as white. Isaac Newton realized this, and he developed something called the Newton color wheel. When you see the various colors when it stands still, and you just spin it. You see how the different colors combine to form a white appearance. And so that's a physiological thing. That's something our brain does through our eyes. It is not, white is not something intrinsic to nature. It's something having to do with our own biology. By the way, an object that absorbs red, green, and blue light at the same time appears black to us. So there's just the, once again, there's a symmetry in nature. Black is the absorption of all three colors. White is the presence of all three colors. Let me emphasize that our eyes don't discriminate specific wavelengths of light. Our perceptions of color are, in effect, mental constructs somehow. Our eyes and brain rework the very complex variety of colors that come into our eyes and perceive them in a much simpler way. This means that when you see the color red, it may be because there's red photons coming into your eye. It may also be because there's a lack of green photons coming into your eye. Either way, you're going to see red. Okay, let's move on even farther to higher energies, ultraviolet radiation, where we begin to get high enough energies that it can be damaging to living things. Ultraviolet radiation is from about 10 to 400 billionths of a meter in wavelength, getting to higher and higher frequencies, higher and higher energies. The energy of ultraviolet radiation is comparable to the energy that holds atoms together, which is why when ultraviolet radiation strikes your skin, it can disrupt bonds, it can destroy molecules, and therefore kill cells if you have too much exposure to ultraviolet. Ultraviolet radiation is itself often divided into three distinct sets of wavelengths. The longest ultraviolet wavelength is called near UV. That's between about 300 and 400 billionths of a meter, and that's primarily absorbed by the skin. It causes the chemical change called tanning, and also causes the production of vitamin D, which turns out to be pretty important. In excessive doses, near ultraviolet can cause sunburn, but it's a sunburn just at the surface of your skin. Then you have radiation between about 200 and 300 billionths of a meter. That's called the far ultraviolet, the far UV. That penetrates more deeply into skin. It can kill cells. And then finally, you have radiation of even shorter wavelengths. That's called extreme ultraviolet. And that radiation is absorbed by the air, so it does not come down to the Earth's surface. It's really not part of our everyday experience. And indeed, the only use of extreme UV that I know of is in science and certain kinds of material research. The sun does produce the full range of ultraviolet radiation, but those only the longer wavelengths get through the atmosphere. The shorter wavelengths are absorbed by the upper atmosphere and actually contribute to the warming. As you go higher and higher in the atmosphere, you get warmer and warmer conditions because of the absorption of this. So you have to go very far up, 50 to 100 kilometers up. But in those regions, the temperature of the atmosphere is actually pretty warm. The shortest of these ultraviolet rays that come through the atmosphere are harmful to us. And if you ever go out on a very sunny day, for example, you go to the beach in the summer, you know that you should put on some sunblock or something else that blocks out these harmful rays. Sunblocks are rated with a number. The number tells you if you have a certain exposure without sunblock in 1 hour, a sunblock of 45, it would take you 45 hours to get an equivalent sort of exposure. Sunblocks are really fascinating chemicals. The trick for chemists in developing sunblock was to find a substance that could be applied in an extremely thin, transparent layer, because you don't want to put a sunblock on and look like you're blue or white or pink or something. And then it has to be a water-insoluble layer because people go swimming. It also has to be transparent to visible light. It has to be opaque to ultraviolets. You have all these different criteria that you have to build into a material, but indeed there are a number of chemicals that accomplish this quite well. There's another use of ultraviolet that I'm sure you've seen, and that's called black light or fluorescence. The brilliant fluorescent display of day glow materials is one example in our everyday life. This is when ultraviolet radiation hits an object and then it glows brightly just in daylight. But more appropriately, you see this in black light shows where, particularly in theaters, you can see brilliant colors just by shining a fluorescent light. Let me show you a couple of objects that are brilliantly fluorescent. In ordinary daylight, we have two objects here that just look dull, sort of pale yellow or gray. But now I'm going to show you these same objects with the lights turned off using ultraviolet radiation. When I shine an ultraviolet light on these materials, you see that the materials absorb the ultraviolet and then re-emit some of that energy as visible light, and that's the phenomenon of fluorescence. So here, a previously dull gray rock, a gray powder, becomes a brilliantly fluorescent rock and invisible ink, which can be used to send messages. Only if you have a black light could you read those messages. X-rays are the next highest energy radiation that can be used and produced by routine technologies. These ionizing waves range from about a 0.1 to 100 billionths of an inch. An atom's about 10 billionths of an inch across, so these are waves that are roughly the size of an atom or groups of atoms bound together. X-rays were discovered in 1895 by William Conrad Röntgen, who lived from 1845 to 1923. He was using high-energy electron tubes, and he noticed that a nearby chemical began to fluoresce when he did this. He suspected there was some kind of radiation coming out of his tube, and he called this mysterious radiation X-rays. X-rays, like all other kinds of electromagnetic radiation, are produced by the acceleration of electrical charges. An X-ray tube produces a beam of X-rays in a very simple way, and I want to show you. This is an actual X-ray tube, glass tube, that produces X-rays for laboratory or medical purposes. And the way it works is very similar to a light bulb, with one important difference. Just like in a light bulb, you have a vacuum tube. Just as in a light bulb, you have electrical current passing through a tungsten filament, a filament of a little coiled wire that gets very, very hot when the current is passed through. But here's the difference. In an X-ray tube, you then additionally apply a very high voltage, a high negative voltage to the filament, a high positive voltage to a copper or molybdenum or other metal plate. And as you apply that high voltage, sometimes 50,000 volts, electrons boil off the filament that's glowing hot, and they come crashing down, smashing into the plate. Because they've accelerated to such a high velocity, those electrons, which are charged particles, decelerate so quickly that they have to emit electromagnetic radiation. Because after all, electromagnetic radiation is just the acceleration or the deceleration, the wiggling, if you will, of charged particles. These electrons wiggle by smashing into the plate and stopping, and that produces a stream of X-rays. The X-rays then come out of a port in more or less a straight beam, and that beam can be used to X-ray your mouth in a dentist's office. They can be used in various kinds of scientific or technological experiments. The great penetrating power of these rays, combined with the fact that they were absorbed by some kinds of photographic plates, made them ideal for looking at the hidden structures in the body. And you've all had medical X-rays. Medical X-rays work because parts of your tissues are transparent to X-rays, more or less, but bones absorb more of the X-rays, and therefore you get contrast in a film. You can start seeing inner structures of the body. And that's how a dental X-ray works. The dentist puts that little nasty piece of cardboard-like material, has you clamp down on it, says, and then the dentist goes out of the room, which always sort of makes you a little nervous, doesn't it? You put this great big machine that comes right down next to your cheek and gum. You're supposed to stand still. You hear a zzzz. That's the X-rays being produced in that high voltage sort of thing. They're passing through your cheek and gum, through your teeth, onto the film, then the dentist can see whether or not you have cavities, because of course a cavity doesn't absorb x-rays, but teeth do. Let me tell you about another important use of x-rays. X-rays diffract off planes of atoms. Remember when I showed you the CD and showed that process of diffraction where you saw the brilliant play of colors in the CD? The same sort of thing happens off the layers of atoms in crystals. X-rays bounce off them in very distinctive patterns. Indeed, those patterns can form beautiful symmetrical arrangements of dots which reveal the size and shape of the atomic arrangement. They reveal the positions of the atoms. An X-ray photograph, therefore, is the key to understanding the structure of matter. And X-rays, because they have wavelengths very similar to the size of atoms and the spacing between atoms, are ideal for this purpose. These days, almost all atomic structures are determined by X-ray diffraction. And then we come to gamma rays, the highest energy electromagnetic waves. These are wavelengths smaller than a hundred trillionths of a meter. Remember, all electromagnetic radiation is produced by the wiggling, the vibration of electric charges. And this is true for gamma rays, but this occurs not with electrons, but with protons in the nucleus of the atom. We're going to see that the nucleus is a place of tremendously high energy, and that you can actually wiggle or accelerate the protons in a nucleus. And when that process happens, gamma rays come streaming out. There are government laboratories such as Oak Ridge National Laboratory in Tennessee that produce small amounts of gamma ray emitting materials, radioactive chemicals, that can be used in medicine and various sorts of research applications. They're used for medical diagnosis, where you take small amounts of a gamma ray producing chemical that then migrates to a specific part of the body, and you can see how that body's working because the chemical gets absorbed into tissues or into a particular organ. For example, you can take a gamma ray emitting phosphorus compound, eject it into your blood, and that phosphorus compound will congregate in places where bones are healing, where a fracture may be remending itself, and so doctors can monitor the process of the healing bone just by looking at the gamma ray emitting chemical. You can also use small amounts of these materials as environmental tracers, because they flow through the water. They emit small amounts of radioactivity that's not particularly dangerous, as we'll see when we talk about nuclear reactions later on. Physicists use gamma rays to study the structure of atoms, and astronomers are really interested in gamma rays because there are objects in the distant heavens that produce bursts of gamma rays. We don't really understand what these highly energetic events are, but they must be quite striking, the most energetic events we know about in the universe, producing huge amounts of gamma rays in relatively short bursts. And that's something astronomers are studying these days. That takes us through the electromagnetic spectrum, but I'm not quite done. In general, we've seen that the shorter wavelengths are more dangerous. They have more energy. But recently, a controversy has swirled around the very longest wavelengths, the lowest energy end of the spectrum, on beyond radio waves at the long wavelength end. These are called ELF, or extremely low frequency waves, waves at about 60 cycles per second, the kind that are used when you produce power in a power plant. They have no real technological applications, but they're constantly produced in our environment by various apparatus that we use. There also is another range of ELF from about 15,000 to 30,000 cycles per second. Those are produced by video display terminals. There have recently been a number of government reports that have come out that look into this question of extremely low frequency radiation. Most people's exposure, even people who are living close to power lines, is not very large. It's similar just to the norm, because these types of radiation drop off so quickly with distance from a power line. Nevertheless, there are high exposures associated with certain kinds of employment. If you're a power worker, for example, power line worker, or if you sit in front of a video display for many, many hours, you may be exposed to higher than average levels of some of these radiation. Is it dangerous? Well, so far, there's no convincing evidence of risk. There have been lots of studies, and let me tell you about some of these. There was a study of 36,000 power line workers in California. They found no increased cancer risk amongst those workers. Then there was a study of 138,000 utility workers in North Carolina. There seemed to be no increased risk of leukemia, but there was perhaps a slightly elevated risk of brain cancer. Not really clear if there's a link there. And then there was a study of 223,000 utility workers in Canada and in France. And that found a slight increase in leukemia, but no increase in risk for other types of cancer. And so we're dealing with statistics here. A lot more research is needed. There's still no cause for alarm, but keep watching the news because that's the kind of study that scientists will continue to engage in. If there's a possibility of risk of these pervasive types of electromagnetic radiation, we need to know about it. Let me summarize this lecture. The key points to remember about the electromagnetic spectrum is that it is a continuum. All the different kinds of radiation, radio waves, microwaves, infrared, visible, ultraviolet, X-rays, gamma rays, they all travel at the speed of light. They're all produced by oscillating magnetic or electric fields. And all these different wavelengths interact with matter by transmission, by absorption, and by scattering. In the next lecture, we're going to begin to look at the interaction of light and matter in more detail at the scale of the atom.